Hey, it's Kevin DeWitt here. Welcome back to the Mixing in a Home Music Studio course. In this video, we're going to talk about audio files. So firstly, if you're new to my channel and new to my videos and you like what you see, click the thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, click the notification bell to be notified of all my future videos. So audio files, all right, we're going to talk about this topic just so we got a bit of fundamentals of audio files under our belt and, you know, what we're talking about and what we're dealing with here. I do discuss this a little bit in the Recording in a Home Music Studio course as well, so it might be worth checking that out to see what I covered in there. Sometimes I forget things to discuss in one but may have covered it in a previous one. But, you know, when we come to mixing, obviously the type of files we use, the type of files we output, all that sort of stuff is going to be a big factor in the quality we get out of this. So to give you a high level overview of these files, and again, you may know these, but we'll just cover it off in case you don't. Generally, there's sort of like when we come to audio now, as opposed to previous where we had like tape and things like that, we're talking about computer-based audio. We talk about two major types, which is lossy and lossless. So, you know, those terms themselves sort of indicate what sort of files they are. So if we talk about lossless, we are talking about files that are generally very big in size. They are going to, as the term is, you know, lossless, they should be a perfect representation of the actual analog audio, right? So there should be no information lost. It should be 100% perfectly a digital representation of the analog sound. Now, these lossless, they come in many factors. There's things like FLAC, WAV, AIFF, right? Different technologies, but all supposedly creating this perfect digital representation. Now, the other one is lossy, which is very common. You know, obviously, if you've had an iPhone and go back to an iPod or MP3 player, all those sort of things, they're all, we're generally talking about lossy formats. Okay, so we're talking MP3s, we're talking AACs. These are generally a lot smaller files, right? So they're designed to be able to put thousands and thousands of songs on a small device for you to listen to. They are called lossy for a reason, because generally the format and the technology, whatever you want to call it, you know, the algorithms, etc., are designed in a way that they will compress the audio, they will remove parts of the audio that they don't think you can hear. So if there's silence, they will remove that data. They may remove information at the very low end that they don't believe people are going to hear. They will remove information at the very top end that they don't believe people will hear to get those files smaller. Now, it's pretty common for a lot of people, especially if you use a very low rough bit rate on an MP3, you can hear that impact, especially on the high end. I hear it noticeably on things like cymbals, on drums. You'll get this really weird shing sound, and it just doesn't sound pleasing or nice. And it's because the technology involved in this has tried to strip away some of that high information, and it just doesn't sound right. Now, if you use the more detailed higher bit rates, 320K, that sort of stuff, you know, then it may not be as perceivable as you think, you know, and it might be, it sounds great, you know, I don't hear the difference, that sort of thing. You know, a lot of people still do, but, you know, you can generally get away with that sort of stuff. Now, the main reason to mention that in mixing is for a couple of reasons. Is it could be you're outputting your files at the end of your mixing session to go to mastering. What format are you going to want to do that in? I would highly recommend that you would be doing it in a sort of lossless format, in a WAV format, 24-bit, very high detailed, that sort of arrangement. You may output MP3s or AACs to make it convenient to go and reference in your car, on your iPhone, whatever else. Perfectly acceptable as long as you understand that you have created a lossy format. Now, when it comes directly to mixing, it can impact you knowing, especially if you're mixing a client song, what files they're sending to you with the instruments. Now, I would always recommend that your audio recordings or the client's audio recordings, each instrument should be done in a lossless format, very high detailed, you know, a WAV file, an AIFF, whatever it is, depending on what software they use. But, you know, I would really discourage anybody from receiving MP3s as the files that they're going to import into their mixing software to mix. Can you do it? Yes. Are you going to get great results? Not the best, okay? Because you've already lost a lot of information as soon as they've done that. And you can't get it back. Once it's gone, it's gone. There's no retrieving it. So that's probably the main reason I like to discuss the audio file basics and the concepts, just so you're aware of that and what you're looking at. Now, some other factors that come into play with your audio files and how we're going to have our mixes run and that sort of stuff is sample rate. So again, in the, I think it's in the Recording in a Home Music Studio course, I do cover this in detail as well, so you might want to check that out to see if there's something I covered in there that I may have forgotten in this one. So generally with sample rate, what we're talking about is that, you know, to get audio into a digital computer, you're basically taking an analog file or an analog source and converting it into a digital format. Now to do that, what it does is it samples the audio file and it creates a data, you know, a one or a zero, something like that, you know, a bit of data information to store so that it can recreate that audio file when it plays out to your studio monitors or your headphones, right? So that's very high level sort of explanation of that. Now your sample rate is how fast and how often it is doing it. So, you know, one general format you might use is say 44.1 kilohertz. That is the speed and the amount of times that it is sampling the audio file to create all the data that it needs to hopefully regenerate it. Now, sometimes the lower the number, the less accurate it's going to be. You know, so I've got some pictures here that hopefully will give you a rough idea of representation. You know, they're my drawing, so take them as they are. They're not like, this is exactly what you get. This is to give you an idea of what we're talking about. And, you know, the lower the sample rate, the less accurate it can represent that audio file back. So then it changes the sound. You'll get some weird artifacts, you'll get some weird noises, that sort of stuff. Now you might say, okay, well, let's go up to the top. Let's go up to 192K, that sort of thing. Yes, you can do that. If your system can support it, you're quite welcome to do that. But a lot of people will claim that they don't hear the difference between that and 44.1K. Some do. Some claim they can, right? So I'm not going to dispute whether you can or you can't. You know, I'll let that up to everybody's choice, their own. But what that does is it does create very big files, extremely big files, right? So you need to have a system that can take those files. You need to have a system that can process at that sample rate. So for me personally, I generally do most of my stuff at 44.1K. But again, you know, depends if I'm using clients' work, right? So if a client sends me recordings at 48K, then I might decide to mix at 48K just to keep it the same as what they sent me. I might decide that they don't need it to be that, and I'll convert them to 44.1K. What I won't do is the opposite. So if a client sends me 44.1K files, I don't generally increase to a higher sample rate. I won't go to 48 or 96 or anything like that, because technically converting the files will add nothing, because just a straight conversion, you can't add extra information into an audio file that's already been taken out. so it would have no benefit. Some people do claim that going to the higher sample rate will have an impact when you start adding your effects and things like that, and that may be true. I'm not going to dispute that. Me personally, I haven't noticed the need to do that, and I've never really desired to do it. Keeping in mind, I'm working on stuff in a home music studio. I'm not working in a professional studio. I'm not working on grand orchestral information or something like that, which needs very high detail. That's probably more where you might decide to do that sort of stuff. So for me, I just generally work in 44.1K, sometimes 48K if a client sends me information in that regard. But otherwise, yeah, I just keep it simple. And I'm happy with the results that I get at that. But it's totally your choice which you use and what you hear and what you feel is the best for you. Now, the other key factor in it is what we call the bit depth. Now, where that comes into play is generally how many variances in sort of like levels we can have in that audio file. So as in the sine wave, how many levels of variance we have. Now, where that comes into play again is two factors. You know, it again is going to give you a more accurate representation if you have a larger bit depth. Now, again, I cover a little bit more in the recording in a home music studio course on this, but I'm not going to go into great detail here, but there are some pictures here that I had drawn for that course as well, which I'll show again. But again, you can see that the lower the bit depth that you have, the less accurate it's going to be. You're going to get artifacts, you're going to get, you know, not a true representation of what the original audio is going to be. Whereas the higher the bit depth, you're going to get, you know, better results. You're going to get it way more accurate and, you know, a lot more detail in it. Now, I don't generally discuss this one too much because most of the time there's two options, right? This is what most people go for. It's going to be 16-bit if you are outputting it to go to CD or something like that. That is what the standard is. But if I'm mixing or if I'm recording, I'm setting it to 24-bit. No one ever seems to question it. No one ever seems to talk about anything else. That may change in the future, but right now, 24-bit is what I would set all my audio for recording, and I would mix in 24-bit, and I would bounce out at 16-bit to then give to the client. There might be options to bounce out at 24-bit. I would bounce out at 24-bit to send to a mastering engineer or to go to mastering. There are times that with like Apple Music, that sort of stuff, if you're going to have mastered certified for iTunes, you might have to send it out with 24-bit, right? So just check what needs to be done for the output and what you need to go to. But if it's generally just for a normal client that just wants it to be able to put on CDs or something like that, I would just give them a 16-bit output. And that's where it goes. So, you know, it's not really something we discuss too detailed. It's just they're the settings you use and just go with it. All right, so I've got a song here and I'm in Cubase. So to give you an example of what I'm talking about, what we usually deal with, if I open up the pool window here, you can see the audio files that have been imported into this song. So each one of these tracks is obviously presented in here. It's an individual instrument and it's an individual audio file. And you can see from here, there's lots of extra detail, but what we have is 44.1 kilohertz files, 24 bits. Some are mono, some are stereo. Okay, and if I actually expand this type here, it tells you the type of file it is. So we've got some broadcast wave files and some wave files. So I'm not going to go into the difference between the two because I've never, to be 100%, really paid attention to it. But let's just assume they're all wave files. Now, if I go show in Explorer, you can actually see them all here. So here is all the individual actual files. And they're all WAV files. And this is what I generally request from my clients, and this is what I will get. But
As I said, I do also get AAF files, and I find they're generally from people that have Macs or use Logic, because it seems to tend towards that file type as opposed to WAV, but you can obviously overrule that if you wish. So we just import them into our DAW here, and then we start using them and start editing and playing with them and sculpting them, etc. And when we bounce out, we generally are going to bounce out, say, our mix bus, and we're going to bounce it out to a single file. We can obviously bounce out to whatever you like, but you're going to bounce out to something here. Okay, so you can see by default here, I just have this setting, and the reason I have it set to this is MP3, 320 kilohertz, so that's our top quality there. We could tick high quality mode here as well. And 44.1, but we've got a couple options there. I would never go to 32K. I don't even know why you would do that. You might go to 48, but again, only if your original audio files are 48. Now you saw from the pull, I close this, these are 44.1K. Okay, there's no point running this project in 48K or outputting to 48K. The samples are not there. There's no point doing it. It's just a waste. So when I want to bounce out this audio, we've got all of these options here, but this is generally the setting I'm going to go. This is just naming stuff, don't worry about that. And this is the format. So MP3, 320K, 44.1. I output from into this format quite a lot because it's for me to review mixes. Okay, so if I'm doing a mix, I want to take it out to my car, want to listen to it, take it to another computer, another audio source, whatever I want to do, just want to listen to it, want to listen to it rough. I'm not 100% worried about the quality so much. I'm worried about the mix itself. So I just throw out MP3s. Just easier to go and review in lots of places. When I want to go to my mastering side or send it to a mastering engineer, now I switch over to the WAV file. And then you'll see the other options open up here. So again, we've got the sample rate. We're going to match the sample rate. Now we've got a lot more options in sample rate. But again, you're either going to downgrade it to 44.1 if you want to go to a CD, or you're going to keep it at the level that you started at and you worked at. Again, don't increase it, no point. 24-bit WAV, 32-bit float, not a big difference there. I just like working 24-bit, it's just straight. Would never even go to 8-bit. Again, not sure why it's really there. There's probably a purpose, but I don't know what it is. And 16-bit if you want to go to a CD. But if I'm exporting out to go into my mastering sessions, then I'm going to leave it at this. A WAV file, 44.1, 24-bit. There's all these other settings which I obviously don't set here, you know, mono, down mix, split the channels, left and right channels, all these other fancy things that I don't bother to do with. Same with this broadcast wave stuff. Don't do that, okay? You can see here all the other types. Okay, so you've got AIFC, AIFF. That's your MP3. You've then got Windows Media Audio. Never see anybody output to that. FLAC. Now, FLAC is lossless, but it does have a compression level there, so I don't really know much about FLAC as such. I just know that they classify it as lossless, so I'm not really sure how they have a compression level and still be lossless, but if you know the answer to that, then leave it in the comments. Ogg Vorbis is another loss E type, so that's like MP3, but obviously a different format there, created by different people. And then you've got a WAV 64, which again, I don't really know what the difference is with that one and don't use it. I just use standard WAV files. So that's the options you get in Cubase. And depending on your DAW, you'll get either the same options, less options, more options. I personally only work in WAV, MP3. That's what I output to. But as I said, sometimes I will get clients send me AIFF files that I will import. On occasion, I do get clients that send me MP3s, even though I really don't like it because MP3s are compressed. They're not great quality files. So it's not really something I like to do, but if that is the only option and the client is willing and knows that that's a problem, then I will deal with it. But definitely not.
So there you go, that is my take on the Audiophile Basics. Hopefully that's covered enough off for you to just move forward and just, understand a little bit so you know what we're talking about when we're dealing with these files and all that sort of stuff to make sure you're getting the greatest results out of your mixes. So let me know what you think in the comments. If you have any questions or if I didn't cover anything clearly enough or missed something, or you didn't understand something, do put it in the comments. I read all the comments and I'll answer as many comments quickly as I can. If you did like the video, give it a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, click the notification bell to be notified of all my future videos. Hopefully you've enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching and I'll catch you in the next one.